Hey, what's happening? My name is Chris Cusimano, and this is the second episode of our new podcast. It's Podcasting with Cusi. It's designed for real estate tips from any real estate agent, or even if you're not an agent yet and you're thinking about it, or basically almost anyone who runs a small business. We have very tactical and practical tips for everyone on all different levels. And today we're going to talk about the question that I get the most, which is, hey, Chris, I was thinking about becoming a real estate agent. I get this almost every other day, if not every single day. It's obvious why, because the career could be amazing. So today I'm gonna answer that question, and you know, I'll just give you a kind of foreshadowing to it. For a lot of people, it's gonna be yes, and for a lot of people, it's honestly going to be no. Today we're gonna explain that. So we're gonna discuss the pros and cons of being a real estate agent. Then we're gonna talk about the real world stats, which might bring some of you down, but then we're gonna lift you right back with some motivation to get you back in the game. And then at the end, I'm gonna show you how to get started if you decided that a real estate career is for you. I'm gonna show you how to get your pre-licensing school done for free, and also some real world training that you can get started for free also. I'm gonna talk about that at the very end. So before we begin, I promise to document my journey into podcasting, because this is only my second episode. And honestly, I really don't know what I'm doing all that much. What I learned in episode one was, well, my intro sucked, if I'm being honest. So I decided to hire a professional to do an intro, someone whose job it is to do introductions. So we're gonna have that coming out. That's obviously, well, maybe it's at the beginning of this episode. I don't know yet. We'll see. I'll check my emails when we get done here. If it's still me talking in the intro on this one, that means it's not done yet. I thought it would be easy. I've heard other people, podcasters, do their own intros and they sounded fine. I guess I'm not built for it. So I hired someone else to do it for me. So I'm kind of excited to check out that new intro. Two, before I started recording yesterday, I bought a bunch of equipment. I researched online what equipment that we should be using, and I bought it. But I didn't want to wait in typical Chris fashion. I just decided to figure it out, and I pressed record, and I simply recorded through a wired microphone that attached to, I downloaded this app called Fairrite on my phone as a mobile recorder, recorded into that, and exported that audio into my computer. And I edited it with the free Mac program called GarageBand. And it actually, after I was done, I was pleasantly surprised. I'm like, this turned out pretty darn good. From a cheap iPhone mic and a cheap iPhone recorder app and a free GarageBand app on the Mac. And that's all I used. And I almost regretted my purchase of the microphone, but you know what? I decided that quality is key. So I'm gonna keep a microphone, which is right here, actually. By the way, if you're listening, I'm showing people on YouTube what it is, which is the next thing I learned in the next step. So I got a microphone, which isn't plugged in yet because the recorder is not here yet. When I checked the recorder out, the recorder is a device that records the audio, obviously. But when I looked online to see where my package was, I realized I ordered the wrong recorder. It was only for one input. So if I wanted to interview people, I would have to either get another recorder. So there's recorders out there where you can plug in multiple mics and it will record them all into there. So I'm gonna leave this solo recorder when it comes here for my at-home corner office that I'm in now. And then at my real office, I'm gonna have the multiple recorders. So that's where I'll be doing interviews and all that. So all good, lessons learned. Oh, what came with it is this cool little handy dandy like thingy. If you're listening and not seeing, it's like one of those, it looks like a studio film that goes between your mouth and the mic. Apparently it helps with, I don't know, sound effects and slurring or something. I don't know, B sounds, I think the box said, not too sure, but whatever. It's a little cool thing that we'll put on later on. And some people might be hesitant to record before they get their equipment. And I would say don't, because even if the quality of the sound is not as great as you hear as professional radio broadcast, it's the quality of your content that people listen to. You're never gonna hear someone go, well, he didn't sound all that great. Great information, but I'm turning off because he doesn't sound that great, you know? And you never heard anyone say, I listened to this guy's podcast. They'd ever say they listen because you have good voice quality, but they listen because you have good content and good substance and quality. So anyways, that was number two. The third one is, if you're watching this on YouTube, well, I put you on YouTube, or I think I put you on YouTube. I'm not sure. I am recording with two different cameras. I'm recording with my iPhone, which you can change the settings on your iPhone to record into 4K. And then I'm also recording on my Mac camera, which isn't that good. And I'm gonna try to merge both of these together and split cameras. I don't know yet if it's working. If you're seeing me on two different cameras on YouTube, then it worked. And if not, then it didn't. And if you're looking at me straight on, it's from my computer. If you're looking from the side, it's from my iPhone. So again, we're gonna figure this thing out and I'm gonna document my journey as I go. So let's talk about why we are here today. Today is about if you wanna be a real estate agent. And I think we really need to start with the numbers on that. So in order to really get a full grasp and a meaningful education or thought process if you should be a real estate agent or not, let's dive into the stats. Stats are key. So in 2020, there are 5.64 million real estate sales that performed in the United States. But there's only 1,564,547 agents. And if I can do math, I don't know, what is that? I've never been really good. Let's say four. Let's say that averages out to four sales per agent for 2020. But let's be real though, there's top producers like myself and a lot of agents and colleagues of mine who do really well, who pushes 30 sales, 50 sales, 100 sales per year. That's heavily skewing that number, where the likely scenario is that most agents are doing closer to zero, one, or two, or did that last year. So, and I guess proof is in the pudding, because the average income is $43,330 last year. $43,330, which again, it's kind of skewed because agents like myself make way more than that. And other high-end top producing agents make way more than that. So truth be told, their income's probably closer to $10,000. And as a matter of fact, I know that is accurate, because the next stat that I pulled up is that average real estate agent who's been in the business for 2 years or less earns less than $10,000 per year. So if you're an agent 2 years or less, the majority of you are gonna earn less than $10,000 a year. Not the cream of the crop, but just the most people who entered the business. But the good news is that 64% of real estate agents who are in it for 16 years or more average $150,000 or more a year, which is a very, very good income. But if you don't have 16 years, well, if you can make it 6 years, then that's time when most agents, the higher than the 50% mark, the better than average agents, will be making their six figures. So here's the kicker though. A big kicker I wanna put out there that people don't talk about. Yes, that's the money you take in, but that's income. That doesn't really account for the money that you spent, because remember, you have to remember, this is a business, this isn't a job. No one owes you anything. You need to spend money to make money. You need to reinvest in your business. This is not an employee job. So if you invest in your business like you're supposed to do, you're probably wondering, well, how much should that be? Well, according to the greatest real estate book ever written, or that I ever read, it was written by Gary Keller. It's called the MREA. Actually, I have a copy right here if you see it on YouTube. It's called The Millionaire Real Estate Agent Book by Gary Keller. Actually, this is my signed copy, I think. I have a signed copy from Gary somewhere. And if this is it, yep, there it is. Look at that, how cool is that? Of course, if you're listening, you can't hear it, but what I'm doing, I'm showing the screen my signed copy of Gary Keller. Awesome. This book really changed my trajectory of my career. A really good book. But in this book, they talk about everything real estate related. And in it, it says that you need to invest 30% back in your business. What does that entail? Well, that's going to be a future podcast. But anyways, my point was that although you saw that was income, that doesn't include cost of sale. So the income should be about 30% less than that. So another stat that I pulled up was that out of the 1,564,547 real estate agents, 21% of them who were surveyed said that they weren't too sure that they would be in the business for much longer. I mean, that's and that's just the people who admitted it. And the reason why is because, let's be honest, this is a hard business. And in order to have someone hire you and represent you in their biggest financial decision in their lives, they need to trust you, and they gotta trust that you're not gonna screw this up, and that you'll be honest and competent and not have what's called commission breath. And if you are, what commission breath is when you're making it very obvious that you care more about the commission than the relationship that you have with your client. And if you're not making many sales, then it's much easier to have commission breath, be focused on the commission, than focus on the relationship and the impact you're having for that family. People have to trust that that's not gonna happen with them. As we know from calling friends just to hang out, getting people to come for not just for their self-interest and be competent enough to actually show up to a party is hard enough. Never mind finding a real estate agent who is competent enough to handle the transaction of the sale. The people need to trust that you're going to do that. A couple things that I want to touch on if you're thinking about being inside of real estate is that when I coach people, one of the biggest things I coach people is that you need to treat this, this is a business. This isn't getting a job at Chili's. This isn't getting a job at a doctor's office. This is a business. You need to treat it as such, and you need to treat it seriously. So in addition to that 30% that you're going to reinvest into your business, you got to show up to work. All right, so you have to show up to work. And what I always tell people is that you come in at 8:30 and 9 at the latest. If you can get earlier, great. And you spend the first half of your day up until noon or so really making connections and working through your business plan and your marketing plan. And in other words, prospecting for business. There's a number of ways that you do that. I teach my personal way of doing it. There's a website called thesuitupagents.com. And we also host free Zoom trainings every Tuesday nights where I show you how I do these things. But anyways, whatever method of prospecting you want to do, that really should be the first half of your day. And then what you want to do is you want to grab your lunch at your desk. And on your computer, you're going to watch training videos of how to get better at your business. And you're going to do that while you are eating lunch, you're being productive. And then after you're done putting your lunch and you're ready, you got your hands free and you're ready to go, then I'm going to advise you to either get back in the prospecting if you don't have any clients, or you're going to start working on your business as opposed to working in your business. So what does that mean? Working on your business and working in your business. When you're working in your business, you're actually doing the job. You're drawing up contracts, you're showing homes, you're in negotiations and all that stuff. But working on your business is where you really focus on growing your business. Maybe it is how to hire the right person. Maybe it is how to master your craft and negotiating skills, or master your listing presentation, or master how you work with buyers and learn all these skills. So no matter what you're doing from the morning until you go home, if you're not on appointments, you are working in and working on your business. That's what I always tell people to do. The next thing I want to always advise people is that you want to first be the person that you want to be. What does that mean? Well, be the person that you want to be simply means you want to start dressing, you want to start acting, you want to start speaking like, you want to start educating yourself like, and showing up as, and most importantly, thinking like the badass agent that you want to be. I see it all too often, and truthfully, way more agents do the opposite than do this, is where they show up the office in casual clothes and they treat the office like a casual hangout where they're just talking buddies. They're usually in the lunch break room or by the coffee machine, trading war stories, talking smack about their clients, and then they wonder why they are struggling. It's because they aren't taking this seriously. And by seriously means doing the things I told you before, showing up early, building relationships, prospecting with people, eating lunch at your desk, educating yourself, working in and working on your business all day, every day. And then if you do this for months, if you do this for a long period of time, 6 months, 7 months, 8 months, maybe even a year, then maybe it starts to look good financially for you. But it takes that long to really get going every day, day in, day out, day in, day out, day in, day out, day out. So whenever I see people going, oh, I'm going to do this on the side, I'm going to do this part-time, or, you know, I'm just going to do this for extra cash. I want to talk about, ironically, those two main reasons that I hear all the time that people enter real estate, that they're going to get in quickly. They want to get in because it's low barriers of entry where they can get in quickly and they can make cash. So they're looking for quick cash, which is ironic because that is the exact formula for failing. In real estate, there is no quick cash. The only people who are going to hire you when you first get in, or people who feel bad or feel guilty because they're your friend or a colleague or sisters or brothers or whatever when they hire you. But if you don't have an actual game plan, if you don't have a work ethic, if you're not building your business, working on your business, checking market stats and educating yourself on what's going on so you can be a true professional, people, that source of business is going to dry up real quick because you're not going to do a really good job. So even if you get a deal here or there just because it landed on your lap, that's not a sustainable business plan and it's not going to last long. Two, if you focus on just making money as your primary motivating factor of being a real estate agent, then you're not going to do well, because in order to be good at real estate, it's such an emotional business, an emotional time for someone. You have to be a trusted colleague, and the key word there is trust. They need to trust you, that you care more about the relationship you have with them more than anything else, more than your own commission, more than your commission breath, as we spoke about earlier. So relationships are key, and people are going to see right through you if you're all about your commission. We have a saying on our team, it's called people over profits, people over profits. In other words, what we mean there, we rather a transaction, in other words, our commission, to go down the tubes at a financial loss to us if it was not a benefit for our client. And the flip side to all of that is, by focusing on our client's needs more than our financial gain, the flip side is it will grow your business even more. So you may, if you're not looking with blinders on, and if you're looking far out, the bigger picture, let's say John's deal was canceled, it wasn't in his best interest. His brother, who is an agent, who just cares about it, he just got his license and cares about his commission more than anything else because it's his side hustle, it's for extra quick cash, wants that check more than he wants to be a true professional. He puts him in a situation that that's good for him. Now he's living in a house, maybe he spent a bunch of money, maybe foreclosures, maybe struggling financially, and that relationship is sour. However, let's say John hired a professional like you, or like myself, or someone on our teams, or someone similar, and they get an amazing experience. However, something just didn't pan out, and it was in that person, John's best interest, that he pulled John aside, like, hey, I don't think this is a good thing for you. Let's move on. John's gonna appreciate that a lot more. You might have lost that commission then, but when John does sell or buy in a later date, John will be using you. And consequently, or the result of that even further, is that John's gonna tell everyone about you. So if you need a selfish reason to be a good person, then that's it. However, you should seriously be in it because you're just a good person and you want to represent your people well. And if you want to represent your people well, you need to be in this treating them like a job, like a real career, like a full-time profession, because that's what your clients deserve when they hire you to pay you the money that they're paying you. On the flip side of that, I highly recommend that you join a brokerage who trains you like a professional. So often real estate agents, and I'm going on a bunny trail tangent here, they focus on brokers who are cheaper or don't have, or you know, they really offer anything. Well, in the absence of value is a lower price. So you have to ask yourself, what makes more sense? Going to a broker who gives you tools, training, culture, that's going to grow your business, where you're going to be a better real estate agent, not only for you and your family, for people? Or do you care about the short-term savings of your business, which is inevitably going to just lead you down to be in the bottom barrel of the income producers that that we spoke about before? You have to make that decision. I know those were stats, and I know I kind of gave you like a little punch in the gut there, but this is when it gets more exciting. And this is what I tell everyone when they're thinking about getting into real estate, that even though this is hard, this is a good thing. Most people look at this as a hindrance. None of you, of course, because you're here on this podcast or watching this vlog on YouTube. But most people see this as a hindrance. Most real estate agents see how hard it is and they walk away. It wasn't that easy money that they were expecting. They might have made a deal or here or there, but they really didn't get what they thought they're going to get by being a real estate agent. I mean, the numbers just prove that. But the smart people like yourself realizes that more challenging it is the bigger opportunity for you to do well. The harder something is, the more rewarding it will be. The harder something is, the less competition there will be. And the harder something is means that less people are going to be competing with you to take business from you. And essentially that's what you're doing when you're entering in any business. When you enter a new business, you are not creating new business. You are taking business from someone else, business that would have went to someone else. For example, let's say if we talked about this book. Let's say if I opened up a bookstore, I moved to a new town, or you moved to a new town, and there was a bookstore there for 50 years, and then you moved to town, and you opened a brand new bookstore. Well, there wasn't a need for another bookstore. The business was already there, that amount of business was there. You didn't create a new need. What you're trying to do is create business from that established bookstore. So when you become a real estate agent, remember, that's essentially what you're doing. You're taking business for someone else. And the best way for you to take the business is just being really good at what you do. And don't look at that as a negative thing. That's a good thing, because this industry honestly needs good, solid real estate agents who treats it professionally and treats it seriously like a real career. Again, the harder it is, the better that it will be for you. So if you accept the challenge that you are in, how hard it's gonna be, and you work through it and you're tenacious, there's no reason why you can't have an amazing career, why you can't be a top producer. I'm a top producer, and I barely graduated high school. You can be a top producer too. You can do well. You have to be tenacious. You have to be hungry. I would advise you to burn all your bridges. If you need a side income to get going, I highly recommend you save 6 months worth of income, put it in the bank, quit your job, and go back into real estate full-time on the schedule that I mentioned earlier, and doing the things. If you want to know exactly what you do, we're going to talk about that through the rest of this podcast. No worries about that. And as I mentioned before, Tuesday nights on Zoom are free. You can jump on anytime and join us. A link will be in the description, or you can email me, message me, and we'll get that out to you. So join us for free on Zoom. It'd be awesome. Cool. So after you're looking at the stats and kind of give you a little reality check and give you a little motivation that you could do well, you can change your life, you can change people's lives, and you can get in it, you want to move forward and you're wondering where you begin, if you want to go to a pre-licensing school, there's a free one that you can do right now. Ironically, the company that I work for, Keller Williams, just released a free real estate school for getting your pre-licensing education. This is the education you need to get your license, which essentially is the first step. You can get this if you go to kwschool.com of realestate.com, KW, so Kite and Whisper, I guess, schoolofrealestate.com. And there you're gonna see two options. You're gonna see KW Prep and you're gonna see KW, or then you see pre-licensing. KW Prep is not needed to get your license. It's another free supplement that KW is offering, Keller Williams is offering you to kind of supplement your business. It'll take you beyond what the licensing class will take you to help you start with your business the right way. And then the pre-licensing is what you need. So you'll click on enroll now and you can pick on those two tabs. If you just wanna get your license, you pick on pre-licensing. You're gonna, on the map there, you're going to find the location closest to you, and then it's going to give you an email address or the phone number and or both of the market center that will reach out to you to get you going for free. And if you want to be awesome, thinking about going that route, put my name down as your sponsor. I would appreciate it. I'm the one who told you about it. Put me in as a sponsor. If you do that, I'll make sure that I take care of you, do some cool perks, get you on the phone or do something. We'll talk personally about some personal training and stuff like that. So do that. If not, I understand too. So if you'd rather not enjoy a free school from the largest real and most successful real estate broker in the nation, then that's fine. Just plenty of paid options. I personally like realestateexpress.com. There's a link of that in the description down below if you're watching YouTube, or maybe it's in the podcast. Again, I'm still not too sure if there are descriptions in podcasts. I'm still learning this whole thing out, but if so, I'll put that link in there, realestateexpress.com. So there'll be a link there. And then there's a bunch of other ones. You can simply do a Google search of real estate schools, online real estate schools, and you can find them. But I like Real Estate Express, so that's a good one. .com. And again, but you can get a free one at kwschoolofrealestate.com. Now, if you want to talk about the ways that I generate my business, I don't cold call, door knock. I don't do any of that stuff. And I teach everyone again free Tuesday nights on Zoom. Or you can jump into the suitupagents.com. Suitupagents.com. Go on there, you log in for a week for free, and then after that, it's less than $2 a day. No contracts, cancel anytime. And again, it comes with a bunch of cool perks. All right, cool. So that is it with today's podcast. Our next podcast we're going to talk about is if you decide to become a real estate agent, you might be wondering what brokerage that you want to join. Is it Century 21? Is it Kai's? Is it Coldwell Banker? Is it Keller Williams? Is it REMAX? Is it EXP? Is it Compass? You know, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to sit down and do my research and talk to my colleagues in each one of these different brokers, get the pros and cons of each, and then I'll lay it out for you in my opinion on which broker is best for you. And then you can make that decision what's best for you and your business. With that, guys, once again, I want to thank you for your time. I know your time is valuable. So if you spent the 20, 25 or 30 minutes with me, I don't even know how long this has gone for, then that's something that I don't take lightly. And I hope I provided enough value for you where it made your life better. All right, with that, I'll see you guys on the next podcast or video log if this is on YouTube. See you around.